I would like to thank the Irish Presidency as well as the Institute of International and European Affairs for organizing this event. 10 years have passed since the EU-Western Balkans Summit in Thessaloniki in June 2003. The Thessaloniki agenda confirmed the EU accession perspective for all the countries in the region, and the language adopted was very clear. The future of the Balkans is within the European Union, and we still firmly believe in this. Why is it that Austria attaches so much importance to the continued enlargement process in the Southeast European area? First, because it is our neighborhood, both of the EU as such, as Austria in particular. Our dense network of bonds with the Western Balkans is based on our geographic situation, common history, as well as human and economic interlinkages. Today, to give you some figures, Vienna, with 180,000 Serbian citizens, is considered the fourth largest Serbian city in the world, after Beograd, Novi Sad, and Chicago. Or, beside this, Austria is home to large communities of 130,000 Bosnians, 70,000 Croats, and 40,000 Kosovars. Many of them came as refugees from the wars in the 1990s. Also, these connections facilitated the expansion of Austrian companies to the Western Balkans. They have been among the first foreign investors in these regions, preparing the ground for many others. For example, in Croatia, which is now about to join the European Union, 750 Austrian enterprises are active there, making Austria the biggest foreign investor in this country. Secondly, we believe in the power of enlargement for the transformation of the region and for the good of the European Union. Regrettably, enlargement has slipped down the EU agenda in recent years. Our attention is presently more directed towards the EU internal affairs and to other external, more burning regions. Yet while combating the current financial and economic crisis as well as structural deficits within the EU, we must not neglect progress on enlargement. A pause in this enlargement process at this critical moment would put the EU achievements at risk and damage the EU's credibility. Therefore, we have to thank you, the Irish Presidency, for promoting the enlargement agenda. We must not waver in our commitment to expand the zone of stability, peace and prosperity to our neighborhood by offering a clear EU perspective to the Western Balkan countries. Enlargement has increased the EU's influence on the global stage. And what are the lessons for the Austrian perspective since Thessaloniki? The Copenhagen criteria set out the right principles for the EU's enlargement policies. Therefore, we should apply them very strict and without compromise. As all previous examples in the enlargement process have shown, our approach of insisting on reforms before moving to the next step of integration works. At the same time, we have to meet our own promises and obligations when these reforms have been implemented. With regard to accession talks, Austria, as a strong advocate for the rule of law, fully supports the new approach of the Commission to start negotiations with Chapter 23 and 24. This approach applied for the first time to Montenegro as an important practical lesson from previous enlargements. Another important lesson is that we should start accession negotiations early. We have seen in the past that the accession process serves as an effective driving force for reforms, as a catalyst for transformation, and as an anchor of stability, prosperity, and peace. It is therefore important to give those countries who are ready the chance to start accession talks. Holding them back on the grounds of bilateral issues is short-sighted, and it undermines the credibility of the entire EU. We thus need to make sure that bilateral disputes, territorial, financial, historical and others, are kept out of the integration process. And finally, to mention it, tools such as the instrument of pre-accession assistance or the EU twinning partnerships have proven to be essential in preparing countries for membership. Based on cooperation between old and new members, they built up expertise in public administration. And let me give now a short outlook on what we expect to come next. Generally speaking, you will agree with me that the pace of progress in the Western Balkans is uneven. Let me stress the positive sides. It is extremely encouraging to see the historical landmark agreement on the 19th April between Serbia and Kosovo, facilitated by High Representative Catherine Ashton. This agreement for us is a major breakthrough on the road towards normalizing the relations between Belgrade and Pristina. It paves the way for both Serbia and Kosovo to move up to the next stage. And we need to seize this unique window of opportunity. In June, we have to decide upon a date for the beginning of accession negotiations with Serbia and the beginning of negotiations on stabilization and association agreement with Kosovo. Serbia and Kosovo deserve this next step be taken. Furthermore, we feel encouraged that Macedonia has made progress in the implementation of reforms in the context of the high-level accession dialogue in nearly all fields, and that steps have been taken to promote good neighborly relations. We continue to remain firm supporters of Macedonia's European future. However, we urge our partners to fully implement the memorandum of the 1st of March. And in Albania, we expect that the parliamentary elections next month will meet high democratic standards and hope that nationalistic rhetoric will fade away and parliamentary work will return to a normal stage in order to adopt outstanding reform legislation. Unfortunately, Bosnia and Herzegovina has made very little progress towards meeting the political criteria and achieving more functional, coordinated and sustainable institutional structures. For us, it is disappointing that the commitments for the accession process have not been fulfilled. And for now, we think that it's very important that the political leaders must find a way to implement the Sejdić-Finci ruling of the European Court of Human Rights. They should finally put the interest of the state before their personal and party interests and need to seek political compromises in order to make progress in EU integration. We see the efforts made in particular by Commissioner Füle, but we think there is a long way for Bosnia-Herzegovina still to be before they really have progress. Mr. Chair, dear colleagues, in concluding, I would like to reiterate my appeal that we must not put our achievements at risk by stalling the enlargement process at this crucial juncture. On the contrary, the EU needs to stick to its commitment made 10 years ago and firmly maintain the European perspective for the whole Western Balkans. Croatia's accession in a month is within reach. That will be a historic and encouraging moment for enlargement, for peace and stability. And it will be a proof of success of the dynamics of the European integration and a step towards our common future with the Western Balkan countries in the European Union. Thank you very much.